Mighty God, we thank you. We thank you tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. What a blessing that we can be gathered here again to listen to your word. We plead and pray that your presence will come to grace this service tonight. Everyone present and under the sound of this voice, bless him.
Amen.
Bless her.
Amen.
If there is someone here tonight who is sick, may you touch the person.
Amen.
Let there be healing.
Amen.
Let there be anointing.
Amen.
Your word says anointing breaks the yoke. You are the burden bearer. By the time we are out of this service, may there be a miracle.
Amen.
Before your children sit down, may they sit on the laps of holy angels.
Amen.
Set someone free.
Amen.
Give hope to those who are hopeless.
Amen.
Give grace to those who are graceless.
Amen.
Now, I plead with you to take control of my mind. May they not hear my simple voice. Hide me behind the cross.
Amen.
Let me not speak my feeble words. Let your power be on my tongue.
Amen.
Not I, but Christ.
Amen.
Be honored, loved, and exalted.
Amen.
Not I, but Christ. Be seen, be known, and be heard. Not I, but Christ.
Amen.
In every look and action, not I, but Christ.
Amen.
In every thought and word, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Shall we be seated? As I always do, it was Jesus himself who said, if you continue in my words, then you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. If the Son sets you free, you shall be free indeed. Can you say an amen there?
Amen.
I want to make you four promises. Five. But before I do so, I want to welcome all of you to this Bible lecture series. We have dubbed The Untold Truth. The Untold Truth. The first promise is the Bible is going to be the bedrock of our study. The reason is the Bible means what it says and says what it means. Today, people undermine the authority of the Bible. God is not a comedian. When he speaks, he knows what he's saying because he means what he says, and he only says what it means. In other words, anything you find in this book, believe it, accept it, do it. The Bible shall be the bedrock of our study. Promise number two, you are going to be enlightened irrespective of who you are, because the Bible says his word, or the word, is a light. So you shall be enlightened. Promise number three is you shall be challenged to make apparently the most important decision of your life. Promise number four, those who love the Lord, they shall be baptized. Will you say an amen to that one?
Amen.
And the last promise is your life will never be the same.
Amen.
For those of you joining us, both home and abroad, we are here for tonight with the caption, when shall truth reign? Yesterday we dealt with the caption, Revelations, Blessing, Siren. Revelations, Blazing, Siren. And we talked about the signs
which God in his wisdom has given to us to indicate that this world is coming to an end. Tonight, when shall truth reign? Many people in the world today, they suppress truth. They oppress truth. They disguise the truth. They hate the truth. They deface the truth. They desire to bury the truth. Truth never dies. Truth will always live. There is an African maxim which says, truth is like a cock. When you bury it off inshore, it will flow ashore. Truth never dies. So truth is out of the land. In the realms of politics, lies, 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 deceit, propaganda, everywhere, there is no truth in the land. In the world of religion, lies, 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 everywhere, truth has been slain in our land. In the world of nature, truth is absent. That is why today, if you speak the truth, you become very awkward. It is unusual for people to speak the truth. In marriages, deceit, lies, husbands lying to wives, wives lying to husbands, children very deceitful. There is no truth in the land. The world of our social life, truth is gone. Jesus predicted it, that one day the land will be filled with men, but it will be a truthless land. That is why in the time of the man who tried Jesus, called Pilate, truth was standing in front of him and he was asking, what is truth? In John chapter 8:18, he made the case asking Jesus that what is truth? Jesus said, for this reason I was born, to witness about the truth. Ladies and gentlemen, truth never dies. Irrespective of what men will do, truth will triumph. The first coming of Jesus is more or less his coming to indicate that he wants to establish, he wants to form, he wants to bear, he wants to make sure that truth is established. Revelation chapter 19, verse 11, the Bible says, now I saw heaven was open, and behold, whenever the Bible says behold, it means what a surprise. This is amazing. This is unusual. This is unprecedented. This is not what it usually is. Now heaven was open, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him was called faithful, and his God was true, and in righteousness, in honesty, in truthfulness, he shall judge and make war. And the armies in heavens, clothed with fine linen and white clean, followed him on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it it should strike the nations. And the last verse says, he himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of the Almighty God. Why was Jesus captured to be on a white horse in ancient Rome? when they go to war and there was a victory and they are returning back home, the general, the commander in chief of the armed forces, because they were victorious, they will be singing a song of victory and they will be rushing down the city of Rome. It's an indication that the throne has been victorious, and the women and the men will make two columns and rows, and they will be singing that in the city the men of truth and victory are Baha. So when God in his wisdom wanted to show to John how it will look like, how victorious Jesus will be when he has ransomed those who were faithful to him, God used the symbolism of a white horse to indicate that he who is on the horse was having a diadem. He will be victorious. Jesus is depicted as the conquering chief of the armed forces. So the question is, when Jesus will become more the Lord and the King of Kings, what will precede this event? How will it happen? At the time that Jesus will be declared that he is the faithful and the true, that is the time when truth shall reign. Currently, truth is not in Nigeria. Good luck didn't bring it. Obasanjo never brought it. Buhari will never bring it. Truth is out of Allah. Everywhere in the world, the question is asking, when shall truth reign? Prior to that, the Bible gave a hint. I'm quoting Revelation chapter 18 from verse 1 to verse 5. It said, after these things, I saw another angel coming down from heaven, having great authority. Look at the adjectives. And the earth was illuminated with his glory. What else happened? The Bible says, and he cried mightily with a loud voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen. I will explain this next week. Babylon means Babel. It means the house of idol, the house of confusion, the house of lies, the house of error, the house of counterfeit. So the Bible says, before Jesus will reign and truth shall be in the land, falsehood will fall and has become the Babylon, which has become the dwelling place of demons, a prison for every foul spirit, and a cage for every unclean and hated bird. And the Bible says, for all the nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. The kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth have become rich through the abundance of her delicacies. Some version says of her delicacies, some say of her luxury, some say of her merchandise. And the Bible says, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people. Before Jesus will restore truth to the land, there will be a called out. God will expose lies. The untold truth will be made known to the whole world. There will be a choice between right and wrong, a choice between error and the counterfeit, a choice between truth and deceit. Isaiah put it this way, at that time, before truth will reign, the earth will be defiled. In this context, it says, it's defiled by its people. They have disobeyed the laws, violated the status, and broken the everlasting covenant. Take note of the following. Point number one, Jesus says that the earth will be defiled. Before truth will reign, the earth shall be defiled by its own people. Yesterday, you remember we talked about at the time we have the propensity, the ability to destroy the air, then Jesus will come and he said, destroy those who destroy the air. Isaiah says, the earth is defiled by who? Its own people. How did they destroy it? They have disobeyed the laws. They have violated the status. They have broken the everlasting covenant. The earth and the fullness thereof, David says, belongs to who? God. They destroy, they disobey God's law. Follow me tonight very carefully. Yesterday we indicated that Revelation's major theme is about Jesus' coming. And Jesus says, at that time, when the earth is being violated, when the earth is being defiled, when there is lawlessness, when the status are not obeyed, then Revelation 22 verse 12 says, and behold, I am coming quickly. Jesus says he will come. Something happened in Egypt. I want to use it as a typology. A typology means something which is more or less like a miniature of the reality. Because the laws will be defiled, something happened in Egypt. Exodus chapter 5, verse 5. The Bible says, Pharaoh said, I love this. Look, the people of the land are many now, and you make them rest from their labor. Ah, Israelites have become many. Why do you make them rest from their labor? Now, it is curious to know that the Hebrew word that they use to make them rest from their labor is the Hebrew word called Shabbath. It means to keep the Sabbath. Follow me. Immediately, Pharaoh made a statement. If you read verse 4, he says that Pharaoh compelled that no, they must work. Moses says no, they must keep the Sabbath and worship God. Remember Revelation 14, he says worship the true God who made the heaven, the earth, the sea, and the rivers of waters. Pharaoh says no. Immediately, he legislated a law that no one, Israel, must not worship their God. They must not rest. There should be no Shabbat for them. And the next thing that followed, Revelation 15 gave us, and see, I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous. What was it? It says, seven angels having in their hand the seven last plagues, for in them is filled up with the wrath of God. Immediately that happened in Egypt. The next thing that followed was the 10 plagues. Follow me carefully. There's no truth in the land. God wants to restore truth. Men want to follow this God to restore truth. When majority would defile the land, majority would disobey his law, majority would disobey his status. At that time, in the days of Israel, the same was happening. And the king made a law that the children of Israel should not rest. Then the seventh last plague came. I will explain more next week. In this instance, the same event is going to happen. How doom will be the doom? There will be doom. If you read it, Revelation 15 verse 1, the seventh last plague is described as the day of doom. Where would there be hope in a doom stricken land? Doom and destruction is about to hit our land. Is there any hope? I saw something in Titus chapter 2 verse 13. It says, looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and our Savior Jesus Christ. Wait a minute, I want to read it again. It said, looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing. I'm here to announce today, the coming of Jesus is the hope of our world. The coming of Jesus is the peace of our world. The coming of Jesus is the greatest event of our world. I want to look for, I want to hope for the coming of our great God. A world slain in religious duplicity. A world with deceits and untruthful religion. Our only hope is the blessed hope. A world that is filled with terror. A world that is filled with hunger. A world of death. A world of pain. A world of perplexity. Ladies and gentlemen, the only hope for our world is the coming of Jesus. Our world is deteriorating. Life deterioration has set into our world. Look at this carefully. In Genesis 5, Adam lived 930 years. Seth took 912 years. Jared, 962 years. Methuselah, 969 years. How are we living in the days of David? The Bible says, Psalm 90, verse 9 to 10, 70. If by virtue of strength, 80. There is deterioration. There is deterioration. Life expectancy is too short. What is in this life that people are so interested and they are so godless, they don't want to worship God? The only hope for a world of destruction, a world of immorality, the only hope for a canonized, bestialized world is the coming of Jesus. That man has seen no woman in the world to marry but a dog. Pastors, church leaders, pedophilias, sleeping with babies. Even the entire generation, we are doomed. A dog sleep with the cock. A world of moral inaptitude. The madness of our time. That was in my home country, Ghana. 14-year-old boy killed the brother so that he can get money. What is the hope for this world? Death hand us from all angles. Ladies and gentlemen, my question tonight is, when shall truth reign? Jesus told Pilate, in fact, the reason I was born and came into the world is to testify towards the truth. Everyone on the side of truth will do what? Listens to me. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. John 17:17 says, sanctify them through your word. Your word is truth. Psalm 119 verse 160, he says, all your words, Old and New Testament, they are truth. Jesus says, I came to testify to the truth. In other words, the first coming of Jesus is to establish the premise for humanity to understand the truth better. Will you say an amen there? And then Pilate, after Jesus said this, he's asked, what is the truth? How can you leave this place again and be asking, what is truth? Jesus says, I am the way, the truth. So when we say the untold truth, we are talking about things Jesus says about himself, about his kingdom, about his personality that people don't want to talk about anymore. So when we say, when shall truth reign? Who is the truth? Jesus. When shall Jesus reign? The day Jesus reigned, before Israel chose their first king, there was a theocracy. What did I say? There was a what? I didn't hear that. There was a what? Theocracy. God was the king. They dislodged God. The next major event to bring a well-structured system, a well-respected system, is for Jesus to again come. The first time he said, I came so that I will testify to the truth. And anyone on the side of truth listens to me. In other words, not everyone can be on the side of truth. So when he comes the second time, he will come to establish the kingdom of truth. Do you tell the truth? Do you love the truth? Do you follow the truth? How do you determine truth? John 1 verse 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Then he says, sanctify them through your word, for your word is truth. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the lie. In other words, by adhering to every word that comes of this book, you are following truth. Won't somebody say amen there? Amen. So when will God establish his kingdom? The Bible says the world will end with the triumphant entry of Jesus. The Bible bore record that God will set up his own kingdom. The kingdom